Good evening, everyone. My name is Charles. I'm a fellow of the Jeanne Sauvé Foundation, and I'm happy to welcome you all here today. First of all, I should tell you a little about this beautiful house. This is Maison Jeanne Sauvé. It's also the home of the Jeanne Sauvé Foundation. The Jeanne Sauvé Foundation was set up by Madame Jeanne Sauvé. She was the first female Governor General of Canada. And her underlying motivation was that leadership in today's world was going to need persons who can work across cultures and across disciplines. And so she set up this foundation to pursue that objective. There are three pillars upon which this foundation sits. And I don't mean that literally. There are more than three pillars under the ground here, so don't be afraid. But I mean, the pillars I refer to are the ones that give life to the mission of the Sauvé Foundation. And the first of them is the Jeanne Sauvé Public Leadership Program, which is pretty much the reason I'm speaking to you today. And in this program, every 2 years, the foundation selects 12 persons from across the world. These 12 young persons are from different countries and different disciplines. But the underlying denominator amongst each one of them is that each of them have demonstrated a drive to apply their skills or expertise into some community purpose in their home countries. So during the programs, the fellows live together here in the Sauvé House, and they work together here and engage in a series of programming from the foundation. The second pillar is the Jeanne Sauvé Network. And so currently there are over 150 fellows distributed across 50 countries of the world who have been through this program over the years. The foundation continues to provide support and resources for the fellows even after they leave the house to pursue initiatives in their home countries or elsewhere. The third pillar, and definitely not the least, is the reason you're all here today. It's the Jeanne Sauvé Forum. And this forum is an opportunity, is the platform the foundation creates to engage in conversations, public conversations on issues of global significance. And so through these three pillars, the Jeanne Sauvé Foundation hopes to build young leaders, to empower them through the far-reaching and supportive network, and then to engage in crucial conversations on issues that affect the world today. Today, we'll continue our series on social connectedness and international development, which started in the last fall. It's been led by Kim Samuel, who is a professor of practice at McGill's Institute for the Study of International Development. She herself is a leading voice on social connectedness globally. The theme of today is how the activism of women is building connectedness and community. In the fall, this series explored many beautiful and challenging sides of what keeps us connected as humans. Through the months, we had journalists, professors, musicians, several NGOs, including the UN Foundation, come through, and all of them showed us their different sides of the social connectedness coin. So I welcome you all here today, and I wish you all a great evening. I will now introduce Kim Boucher Maron, who is a student of Professor Kim Samuel, and to take the baton from me. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Kim Boucher Maron. I study international development at McGill University, and I am a former student, sadly, of Kim Samuel, as well as a regular attendee of the Jeanne Sauvé Foundation lecture series. Building on the success of the fall series, this is the first event in a series to be held monthly until April. That is the Jeanne Sauvé Forum on Social Connectedness and International Development. During this winter series, they will be hosting stimulating encounters with inspiring professionals who are on the front lines of these twin issues. Tonight's discussion will explore feminist perspectives on how to build connected societies and ways in which women in communities around the world can continue not only to defend their own rights, but also the rights of other marginalized voices. This topic is increasingly relevant, especially with regards to current events. So I would like to take this opportunity to say, on a more personal note, to women, to immigrants, to Muslims and other faith minorities, to LGBTQIA individuals, to Indigenous and racialized people, to people with disabilities, and to any other marginalized groups, that you are an integral part of society, that you should not be tolerated, that you are to be integrated, celebrated, and included. And that's what it means to me to build a connected society. I also think it's important to acknowledge the role that women play in fostering connectedness, whether it be through individual interactions, through communal actions, or global initiatives. We have the potential and the responsibility to alleviate social isolation. And we have the privilege to have with us tonight such women. For one, this series would not be possible without Kim Samuel, a partner and longtime friend of the foundation. Kim is the president of the Samuel Family Foundation, professor of practice at McGill University's Institute for the Study of International Development, and policy advisor at the Oxford Poverty and Human Development Initiative. She is a pioneer in the field of social connectedness and its significance to inclusive policy and program development. She convened the second global symposium on overcoming social isolation and deepening social connectedness last October. And in addition, she designed and delivered the first academic course in this emerging field to graduating students in international development studies at McGill University. I had the pleasure of participating in this course, as well as of having Kim as a professor last semester. And I have to say, I find it very fitting that she will be talking about women building connectedness and community, because that is exactly what she did at McGill University. She created a course which explored the humane and more inclusive side of international development, as well as the need for and the benefits of social connectedness in this field. She encouraged and enabled us to think critically about pressing issues, such as those we'll be discussing tonight. For those reasons, and also because none of my other professors are here, I can say that this was the single best class I have taken at McGill University, which is a top-ranking school, so I think that's a direct reflection on your talent as an educator, Kim. Not only through her work and her countless projects all over the globe, but also on a personal level, she has come to exemplify for me an empowered and empowering woman. So please give a warm welcome to Kim Samuel.
Thank you very much, Kim. I really appreciated your comments, but particularly appreciated the laughter from many of your fellow classmates when you noted that I was your favorite and that you could make that statement because none of your other professors were here. So I think we'll like maybe talk about that later. Yeah, just saying. It's really great to be here. I had the enormous privilege of being able to be a teacher, and I think equally so a student of my students, last fall here at McGill in the first ever class that we know of anywhere on social isolation, social connectedness, and its relationship to policy. What I didn't expect when I came was how much I was going to love teaching. I came to, I guess the word might be legitimize a new field of study. No better place to do that than here at McGill. I really want to help to spearhead a global movement to call out social isolation, to destigmatize social isolation and to build pathways to overcoming social isolation and building social connectedness. And in order to do that, it's very important to work with the academic community, of which I don't really consider myself a member, but I do consider myself a friend, and I think that's mutual. But what I found last fall, and I will say to you, Kim, that this statement will hold even as I get to teach this class much more, is that I fell in love with teaching. And you are my favorite class of students, even though my future students aren't here tonight. So I got to the end of the term. We got to the end of our class, and I realized that it was this wasn't something as a one-off or to try this out or maybe use my syllabus and try to get what I call professors to pick this up, although all of that's true. I found that the heart of this movement that is my passion, my life's work to build, is going to be not just involving young people, but led by young people. And that I hope in future years I'll be looking especially at my first ever class and saying that together we created something. So it really means a lot to me to have all of you here tonight, but in particular going through this day and seeing my students who I still call you my students even though our class is over, so we'll have to start calling each other something else, but I think that we started something important. And to be able to be back here at Sauvé, it was a fall series, a fall course and a fall series, and then got to the end of December. I went back thinking this was wonderful and holiday time and what a great memory, and I hope I'll get to do this again next fall. And then I got into January and I thought, no, I'd actually like to do this again next month. And I'm very grateful to Sauvé Foundation for giving me the opportunity to be able to continue our series now, the winter series, and also to call me their partner in this. I feel very honored to be that. This evening, as we kick off our winter season, we have the opportunity to reflect on events happening all around us and to examine the role of activism and the power of resistance. I can't think of a better theme tonight than what we are going to be talking about, considering the voice and the role of women in supporting positive social change and building social connectedness. And that word resistance coming up again and again, I've been following, I guess we would call it a progressive agenda and progressive websites and progressive thinkers talking about in relation to Donald Trump. We're now day, whatever, however many days he's been in office, day X of resistance, and this is what resistance looks like. And I've been thinking a lot about the women's marches that took place the day after his inauguration, and thinking that's what's galvanized a lot of, and men galvanized women and men, that's for sure. But I think that we maybe all need to look at how to say goodbye to complacency forever, because this is what can happen and in the extreme. So hopefully the positive aspect is the galvanizing that's taking place. Of course, the role of women in social change is certainly nothing new. We can trace the activism of women to the roots of key social changes around the globe for centuries, from anti-war and peace movements to universal suffrage, civil rights, social and economic equality, environmental protection, and the list of causes goes on. The voices of women have lifted all voices. Today, however, there is also something that appears new in the discourse. As we watched the thousands upon thousands gather across the United States and in cities around the globe just a few weeks ago on January 21st, it was interesting to note that the mantra unifying these voices extended far beyond what is typically referred to as women's rights. Activists were also united against threats to immigrants, Muslims, and other faith minorities, LGBTQIA, indigenous and radicalized people, and people with disabilities, among other marginalized groups. The organizers' mission stated, "We stand together, recognizing that defending the most marginalized among us is defending all of us." It was with this in mind that we have framed tonight's talk to reflect on the role and responsibility women both have and need to have in the face of challenging political dynamics. The dawn of 2017 was ushered in alongside some of the most troubling rhetoric and fear of differences among people we've witnessed in a very long time. Politicians, too, have played a big role in amplifying fears and succeeding to win popular platforms on the basis of what I call othering, encouraging withdrawal from multilateral and multinational forums and the building of walls instead of bridges between peoples. These trends are particularly troubling to me. My life's work has been focused on social isolation and calling out this entrenched problem. I've seen firsthand the devastating impacts of social isolation on so many levels. What that means to make somebody feel less than, what it means to feel less than, that you don't matter outside of all circles of concern, to me, is a violation of human rights, and that there should instead be the human right to belong. Social isolation lies at the core of many of the challenges our world faces today. When we isolate and exclude other people, when we tell them they do not belong, when we segregate and stereotype our fellow human being by age or income or ability level or the color of their skin or gender or how they pray and who they love, we diminish what Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. calls their sense of somebodiness. We deprive them of their agency and voice. We send a message that they are less than. Through my work, I've collaborated with partners to highlight the ways in which we can overcome social isolation. And certainly, it seems that all of this is only more relevant in today's context. Fortunately, we've seen that there are building blocks of social connectedness that can and do produce real results. Tonight, we have the opportunity to think about the voice and agency of women and how we can further support their efforts and activism in building social connectedness. I believe that there are a few key ways of accomplishing this, which I'll outline briefly and then move into the rest of the program. First, we must strive to truly see each other eye to eye, to actively listen, and to seek common ground. The point of doing this isn't just to recognize shared vulnerability, nor is it simply to sympathize with someone else's pain. In genuinely seeing one another eye to eye, we can celebrate one another's strengths. We can honor and value one another's contributions. We can demonstrate mutual respect. Second, we must recognize the critical value of reciprocity. Connectedness is a two-way street. When we extend a hand to others, we are touched as well. And third, social connectedness is more than removing barriers and creating access. It requires a proactive approach and investment from all of us. As we think about how to bring connectedness and compassion into the policymaking arena, it isn't just about making sure that marginalized groups get a seat at the table. It's about ensuring that everyone at the table can be a full and equal participant. As my fellow Kim said earlier about tolerance, and I was so pleased that you chose that word to say that's not enough. It's not enough to tolerate can mean I see what you do, and you do what you do, and I'll just look away. Activism is something that I think we all need to adopt in our daily vocabulary and also what we're doing, whether that's an active listener, whether that's marching, whether that's speaking up for someone who isn't there to speak up. So thank you for making the distinction. Instead of imposing top-down solutions, we need to cultivate solutions from the bottom up. Instead of leading from the front, policymakers should get behind the priorities communities identify for themselves. Because overcoming social isolation is always done with and not for. This brings me back to the leadership needed across so many societal challenges right now, and the hope an inspiration we can draw from and become part of. Movements led by feminist ideals and the voices of women. We gather here tonight with the terrible tragedy of what happened just a short distance from us here in Quebec City at a mosque as a community gathered in prayer on a Sunday evening, which is very much in all of our hearts and minds. Amidst the pain and the sadness, we saw people, leaders, and ordinary people alike gather together in love and solidarity to reflect on this event and consider ways in which together we can combat hatred and Islamophobia. Here again, I was touched by the voices of Muslim women, women who bravely spoke out about their fears and also their hopes for their children. Women like Shima Khan, writing in the Globe and Mail, encouraging us to become, in her words, soldiers of inclusion, and appealing to all Muslim and non-Muslim alike to continue to practice the universal virtues of community, generosity, and charity. Along these lines, I was actually reading today an article that was posted on a website by a mom who lost her son in the shooting at Sandy Hook Elementary School a few years ago. And she was writing about overcoming social isolation, which resonated with me a lot, but also made me think about how we choose to take tragedies that strike us and come forward and become leaders. And her voice was speaking to a lot of people. And what she talked about was the importance in a school. Some is to smile and to smile back, which sounds so simple, right? But that doesn't happen so much. When I walk around this campus or other university campuses, I try to make a point, and it's often looking up. I'm not the tallest person on the street, but I just look up and say hello and smile and get over the fact that some people won't look at you or look at you like, what do you want from me? But I think about in school how natural play is. You know, play is should just be a part of school, and I thought, What this mom was writing about, her voice was about spotting something so important that's leadership, and we need to start looking at what is sometimes referred to, in fact, very often referred to as soft skills or soft leadership. Let's take out the word soft. These are skills, and this is leadership. As a seminal work by Bell Hooks, Feminism is for Everybody reveals, a feminist perspective charts an inspiring and action-oriented path forward to achieving positive social change, which I believe very much contributes directly to social connectedness. I'm just going to quote a little bit from Bell Hooks. Feminism is a wise and loving politics. It is rooted in the love of the male and female being, refusing to privilege one over the other. The soul of feminist politics is the commitment to ending patriarchal domination of women and men, girls and boys. Feminism has been and continues to be a resistance movement, emphasizing the necessity of self-love and self-acceptance as necessary for self-actualization. With this understanding, I think we can all become further equipped with new insights and build social connectedness in today's world. I've certainly seen the potential of that in my class. I hate referring to it in the past tense too, Kim. I'm not going to. We're because we developed a community in the class, and now we're a community from that class. I'm thrilled to be able to expand grow our fall series into our winter series. And as I said to some of the students I met with today, we could do this every week for 13 weeks or longer on the topic that we're addressing tonight. First, I'm very pleased to welcome my fellow professor of practice, Dr. Eliane Ubarijoro. Eliane's current research focuses on innovation in global health and sustainable development. She is also a member of FemStep, a research network highlighting rural girls' and women's perspectives on poverty reduction strategies in Rwanda, South Africa, Tanzania, the DRC, and Ethiopia using arts-based methodologies. In this context, she has been developing Ashes to Light, a multimedia project to document intergenerational dialogue on resilience as a platform for wisdom sharing and youth leadership among girls, training and peace building. Among her many other accomplishments and affiliations, Eliane was formerly an assistant professor in McGill's Faculty of Agricultural and Environmental Sciences and is a member of the Rwandan Presidential Advisory Council. She is also a contributor to the upcoming book, The Transforming Leader, New Approaches to Leadership for the 21st Century. I hope it comes out soon because it needs to be on my reading list for my next course. Joining Eliane, I'm pleased to welcome Julie Con Kam King. Julie has been the Senior Program Officer for Equitas Canada since 2009. Equitas, for those who may not know, is a proud Montreal institution that has been working for the advancement of equality, social justice, and respect for human dignity in Canada and around the world since 1967. I have to tell you, I'm an avid reader of your publications, website, and information sharing and programs, and I've quoted Equitas many times, so it's really wonderful to have you here representing. Julie takes the lead in developing partnership relationships, strategic initiatives, and evaluation plans for national programming. This includes overseeing the development and implementation of Equitas's Play It Fair, Speaking Rights, and Young Women, Young Leaders program in 23 communities across Canada. Prior to joining Equitas, Julie developed and manage social justice and legal education programs for a number of nonprofit organizations, including the Ontario Justice Education Network, Educaloa, thank you. I might have checked on that beforehand. I didn't. Thank you very much. And the Asia Pacific Forum on Women, Law, and Development in Thailand. Julie holds degrees in common and civil law from McGill University and a degree in communications from the University of Ottawa. We have two amazingly accomplished women leaders tonight speaking on an amazingly complex, important, and more timely than ever subject. Please join me in welcoming our esteemed guests this evening. We have much to discuss, so let's get started.
Good evening. I want to say a big thank you for inviting me to speak this evening. But more than that, I want to say thank you to all of you, because on a wintry, slightly treacherous out there, I'm going to say evening, many of you may have climbed up the hill as I did from Sherbrooke or have come here and are taking the time tonight to think about women's rights, women's action, women's participation, and invest in that. And so I want to thank you for coming and joining in that conversation this evening. I'm going to do a couple things. First, I'm going to give you a little bit of an overview about Equitas, because maybe some of you may be less familiar with what Equitas does. And then I'm going to tell you about three stories, so three women that I have known in the course of the work I'm doing at Equitas and who are doing just incredible work in their countries. One example from here in Montreal. I'm hoping that will give you a bit of a context around what these women are doing in terms of really shaping community, but also shaping the role of women within those communities. Does anyone in the room know about Equitas, or have you heard of Equitas before? A few? Sometimes we're told we're the best kept Montreal secret, but I'm hoping at some point that will change. So Equitas is a nonprofit organization. We're based out of Montreal. Our office is just down the hill in front of the gates of McGill. We've been around for about 50 years. And we're working in Canada in about 45 communities, and then we work internationally with 15 countries in particular, but we have alumni of our programs that are from 100 countries in total. We also are fortunate to work with a large number of strong women leaders, both in Canada and internationally, who span various disciplines. What do? We focus on educate, empower, and change. And we do this using a rights-respecting approach. Part of what we do is work with partner organizations. We do training for staff, management, whether that be of governments, schools, community-based organizations, civil society. And that training is based on practical educational tools for social change. We also provide activities that people can use in their own programming and work. And additionally, we provide opportunities that build leadership skills for action at the local, national, and global level. What we're really looking for in terms of change is increased participation of those groups who are normally excluded. So making sure that they're at the table, that there are opportunities for them to be leaders in change. And that change is defined on what they are seeing as the sort of everyday issues that are most relevant to them and their communities. We also play a bit of a hub, and we're linking partners and we're linking organizations and governments to talk about what are strategies and what are good practices that we can use and share to inform social change. We do this using an experiential learning process. So what does that mean? Very similar to what Kim was saying, we start from the experience of those that we're working with. So we're not going in and delivering a training of this is how you should approach social change. We start very much with the experience of those partners and participants. They do mapping of their communities and issues. We move from that to building skills, critical thinking skills, knowledge in substantive areas around human rights. And then we look at how do we plan for concrete action. And so when we think about this in respect to women, a core part of that is working with the groups that we do work with to explore what are the root causes that are leading to exclusion of women, that are leading to discrimination, that are leading to social isolation and disconnect. What do these causes lead to? So we have the roots of the problem and how do these manifest themselves in different communities? And then moving from that, what are the strategies that we can come up with collectively to address some of these barriers to participation in public life? I'd like to, in particular, share three stories with you. The first one is from our Mosharka project. So Mosharka means participation. And this takes place in the MENA region, so Middle East and North Africa region. We've been running this program for about 5 years. And there are women who, as I said, from 5 countries across the MENA region who are participating in the program. Part of what they do is come together around training, around knowledge sharing, and define what is the issue that's most relevant for them that they'd like to work on in their community. So I want to tell the story of Nawrez. She's a 24-year-old from Tunisia who participated in our program and has decided that part of what she wanted to do was use human rights and teach human rights to marginalized young women, other youth, and those who have disabilities. She set up, following the work that she was doing with us, she set up her own program. She's now doing human rights education for these groups. Part of what they're also looking at is what are the prejudices surrounding women's participation in the country of Tunisia, and looking at issues of early marriage and also sexual harassment, which are very relevant for their daily existence. I want to read a few words from her. When asked about why is she doing this, she said, part of the goal of my training and my engagement is really to break down isolation. She says, the 2011 revolution that happened, the Arab Spring that many of you know about, inspired her. But we created a revolution for the country to move towards democracy. And if we ever want true democracy to happen and transition, we need everyone to know what their rights are. And hence, this is the importance of human rights education. She also talks about how this Mosharka project has become a part of her, and working with this group has become like a small family who supports and inspires each other. And she says each of those people in the family, even if they're working on different projects, have really built self-confidence, skills, and now feel in a position where they can actually lead in various parts of social change. The next story is from Senegal. So we work with a number of women in Senegal, and I want to talk about Maimouna, who you see on the left. Maimouna is an amazing women's leader. She's a municipal councillor in the suburbs of Dakar in Senegal. And her passion is really thinking about not only defending the rights of all women, but how to inspire other people to aspire to be in decision-making positions. Since we started working in Senegal in 2013, there's about 50 civil society organizations who've become involved in this project. We have about 700 women who are engaged in projects, identifying also at the community level where they'd like to see change. For them, the topic that they most found relevant and that resonated with the work that they were doing was around domestic violence. So part of what they did was to start to foster community conversations about domestic violence, which had never happened before. This resulted in the mayor, religious leaders, youth, journalists, artists, all coming together to have conversations about violence against women. They saw an increase in the number of women who started to come to centers for victims that had never happened before because there was such stigma associated with talking about domestic violence, violence against women. There's now a woman who sits on the community committee for mediation, and it's the first time that men and imams and religious leaders and mayors are talking together about this subject. So for me, I think a really inspiring look at just what is possible within a community. And then the last story I want to share is a little bit closer to home. So this one takes place in Montreal, in Côte des Neiges. And we started a program based out of Montreal, but now that's happening in 7 communities across Canada. It's called Young Women, Young Leaders. This grew out of a real need that was expressed by partners we were working with who said, you know, we have programs in our community centers. The women, young women aren't coming. They also said, we don't feel necessarily equipped to be able to engage young women and to create a space that is positive and create a space that's welcoming and inclusive. So we began this program. It started in Montreal. We worked with 3 organizations here. One of them was in Côte des Neiges, and it was where we inserted our program in part of their regular programming. And what they were running was weekly workshops and activities for young women who were newcomers, who were either trying to encourage to go back to school or to find employment. And when they first started this group, it was really difficult to have young women come on a weekly basis. And then they bought on to the idea of having a project because they thought maybe this would lead to more regular buy-in and commitment. The first time we did a session to talk about the idea of community, they had convened 7 or 10 young women there. And the idea of community was something that was quite disjointed, I would say. We asked the women what they thought of community, and there was one woman who said, she was about 17, and she said, I don't have a community. My community is my bed. I don't belong here. My community is my bed. Over the course of 8 months, we worked with this group. They took part in a bunch of different workshops. They explored self-esteem, confidence building. They mapped their community. They looked at what resources were available. They decided through their project that what they wanted to do was to design a map for other newcomer young women to know what existed in their community and how they could access that. At the end of this project, we had a celebration forum event in Old Montreal, and this same young woman stood up and she said, "This is my community." They call themselves Fleur de Force. "We are Fleur de Force. If you ever need, any young woman who's new to Montreal needs to know about her community or how to belong, we are there for them." And this, for me, was dramatic. When you think about young women who wouldn't even necessarily speak in a group of people, and so clearly felt alienated and quite disconnected, to then feel that they had moved to being a role of contact and communication and having a center position within their community, I think was quite dramatic. The picture I have here is one that inspires me every day. It's a young woman from Maison d'Haïti. She lives in Saint-Michel in Montreal North. She's 12 years old. She participated in our Young Women, Young Leaders project. During the World Social Forum, she decided she wanted to be part of one of our workshops that was done with people from all over the world. She stood up and she led parts of that workshop. Recently, I was also at an event at RBC, and she came to that event and addressed managers of RBC, and I asked her, "Who is it you'd most like to meet next?" And she said, "Well, of course, the Prime Minister, it's obvious." So just an example of, you know, the shifting role that can exist for young and women leaders and communities. And I think I'll end on that note. If any of you are interested in knowing more about the work we're doing at Equitas or becoming involved, I'm certainly happy to answer questions about that. Other than that, I just wanted to say again, thank you for thinking about these things today, and I look forward to continuing the conversation with you.
I love that you ended on a 12-year-old young woman. I have a 12-year-old daughter, and she inspires me every day. And one of the things that I think is very critical in terms of what you were saying, and that's important for all women around the world, and all the women here, is this idea of self-love and self-confidence. We all know that we're not at equal pay yet. And we know that there are parts of that that we can't do a lot about. But we can work on self-love and self-confidence. And one of the things that a lot of studies have shown is that women will apply for jobs that they have all the qualifications for. So they usually apply for jobs they're 110% qualified for. And men will apply for jobs that they're 30% qualified for. And so what happens in the career ladder when you have two people who have the same degree, and one is applying for jobs they're overqualified for, and one is applying for jobs that they're stretching for? And so there are ways that inequality is inherent in the system, and there are ways we have the power to change that. And the more we develop self-love and self-confidence, the more we're able to move forward in that direction. There's a great book on competence versus confidence in women. And what it says is that we have the competence, and often is, do we have the confidence in ourselves to move forward in the way we need to? And often promotions come not because of competence, but because of confidence. And so the energy we put out in terms of how other people feel that we project ourselves is as important as all the learning all of you are doing here while you're students at McGill. So remember that and take time to nurture yourselves so that that place of self-love, self-confidence, the prioritizing care of our bodies, our souls, our spirit, our hearts, is really put at equal footing with enriching what we have in here. And so Kim mentioned my involvement in FemStep. So I was involved in FemStep from 2008, 2015. And the culmination of that was in 2014, was getting a Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation grant to look at participatory research in Rwanda with rural women farmers. And the excitement for me in this whole process was, I'm a woman scientist. I'm trained, I have a PhD in molecular genetics, and I have merged, and now I'm part of the Faculty of the Arts. And what the process for me when I started working at the interface of science and arts was really, I had phenomenal women feminist researchers who really championed me through FemStep, women researchers here at McGill, from South Africa, from DRC, from Tanzania, and it was amazing how supportive all of these women were in my own path. And Madeleine Albright says that there's a special place in hell for women who don't support other women. And so my question is always, how can I support other women? But also, how can I support myself? Because sometimes we support others, but we forget to support ourselves. And so it's the importance of juggling those two aspects. And so part of the feminine journey to empowerment is interior work as well as exterior work. While you're here as students at McGill, a lot of the work you're doing is exterior work. You're building your credentials to get out there in the world to fight for social justice for all who are marginalized in the world. But while you're doing it, do not forget to cultivate what makes your soul sing. Because often what happens is when we are in service of others, renewal and ensuring that we have the energy to do the work that is needed is equally important. And so preventing burnout is something really essential. And so I've been involved now for a few years with something called the Fuji Declaration. And so the Fuji Declaration brings people from all over the world, and the intent is to spark the divine essence for each human being so that we can all contribute to the empowerment of all humanity and to the sacred protection of the earth we live on. And as part of the launch of the Fuji Declaration, in May 2015, I had the opportunity of standing at the base of Mount Fuji with 8,000 people and hearing prayers for each official country of each country on the planet said. And it was a very empowering moment for me because I come from Rwanda. And in 1994, I was a master's student at McGill doing my thesis in molecular virology. And while I was writing my thesis, I had no clue if anybody I loved in Rwanda was alive or dead. Many friends, many people in my extended family were lost. I had the luck of my parents survived, and my older brother who was there survived. His house was burnt down. And I had the luck to have my parents present in my life, my mother for 11 additional years and my father for 12 additional years. And it was important for me when I was standing at the base of Mount Fuji to remember the place of isolation I felt in 1994 when I was a student in Montreal, and all the images I was seeing of my country of birth, Rwanda, were hell. And I remember a Times Magazine cover that said hell on earth, and it was an image of my country of birth. And so as I was standing at the base of Mount Fuji, and we were praying for each country, I remembered that there was a time in my life where I felt so isolated that I worked on my thesis at night because sleeping was too hard. And what I realized is no matter who we are on this planet, we will have moments where we feel isolated. And if we have access to a smile, a gentle hello,
someone coming to us and saying, I see you. I really see you. It can help us take the next step, the next breath, so we keep going. And something else I'd like to say. So on Saturday, it's the International Day of Women Scientists. So if you, any of your friends are students here at McGill in any sciences, please tell them to take a picture of themselves and tweet it, okay? And so there's a special hashtag. I don't have it memorized, but there's a special hashtag associated of I am a woman scientist. And so I'm going to tweet out my picture on Saturday with the hashtag related to that special day. And one of the reasons why I feel it's important for me to talk about what it is to be a woman scientist is we live in a world where technology has the power to change so much. But at the same time, we live in a world where less than 7% of technology companies are led by women. And so what that means is that there is a lot of technology that's coming out that isn't shaped by the minds, hearts, and souls of women. And there's a really fascinating book that I'm reading right now called Innovating Women. And what it talks about over 300 stories of women fierce innovators in the world. And what is really interesting about each of their stories is there are each stories of immense resilience, persistence, perseverance. Maya Angelou used to say that who is your ray of sunshine in the cloud? I don't have the exact expression, but I remember her. I remember it was really this, your rainbow in the clouds. And so one of the things that I've realized is we all need somebody who shines the light in our moments of despair. And all of these women had either fathers, mothers, partners, brothers, sisters, friends who helped them get through the darkest parts when they were like, I don't know if I can keep going. The system is so hard to get through. And somehow they did. And what was interesting is that the research shows that innovating women will create to be of service to the world. They're not interested in gizmos, gadgets, dates, like what is it I need to do to be of service to the world? And so one of the things I feel is that the more women innovators we have on the planet, the more power we'll have in women's pockets, the more power we'll have at the negotiating table, and the more power we'll have to influence social justice. And for me, it's not about just being a woman in Silicon Valley, really defying the odds, a place where there are half the number of women in computer science in the US today that there were in 1985, okay? This is a very hostile territory for women, and numbers have gone down considerably. But it's also about the woman in Zimbabwe in her village who's looking at how microcredits can help her ensure that her daughters go to school and can go and have an education beyond what she was able to have. And so what it is it's really about all of us. All of us carry in ourselves inclusion and isolation. And the more we face what is in us, and the more we're able to befriend that place of isolation within, the more our contributions to including everybody else, all others, is possible. Because the other is in here. What is the shadow that I carry that doesn't allow me to accept me and see me? And when I'm able to do that, the power that it brings is phenomenal. And what we saw with the Women's March was this space of immense rage, power, passion. Kim talked about complacency, no more place of complacency. And so what happens is when we are pushed to our limits, we go beyond our fears, beyond our shadows. We go beyond doubting ourselves to saying, I am here, I exist, I want my place at the table. I want to be heard, I want to voice what I have to say, and I want to participate. And so the excitement of 2017 is citizen engagement for me. And one of the things is that the more we engage as citizens locally, the more power we have to influence change here, but also elsewhere in the world. And what we see is that a lot of people wondered for a long time, well, does my vote count? And I think people who doubted that have realized that there is a role and responsibility to voting. And that if we don't show up, someone will make those decisions for us. And I think it's really important that what we do as women here really involves looking at who we are, what is it we can do, what is it we need to learn for ourselves so we can participate fully in all the ways we need to, but also not wait to be fully ready and to accept that we will go into the arena never fully prepared, but that we, in that space of reciprocity, that we must remember our responsibility to ask for help. And sometimes when we, as women, live in our heads, we forget to ask for help. And so that's something I encourage all of you to remember, because there are always people out there wanting to help you as much as you want to help others. And opening to that place of reciprocity, of giving and taking, in my opinion, is one of the fundamental issues around poverty in the world. People don't want to receive, they want to give. Everybody wants to give, whether you're somebody in Haiti right after the earthquake, whether you're somebody in South Sudan after civil unrest. No matter where you are in the world, you want to give. You want to give with dignity. And so it's not about what is it we can do for others, but how is it we can help each other be giving? And that process requires us to open, to be of help, and to ask for help. Thank you.
Thank you both very much. I think I speak for the rest of you here. I mean, we could have listened for a couple more hours. The sharing of stories, personal stories, as well as the stories that become personal through the lives of women are really powerful. I love that there's a day for women in science. But that's an aside, I guess. But I love that there's a day for women in science. Students in my class created a Facebook page that is still very alive and well, and we're going to put that on there. We have some women in science in our group too. We're now going to move to discussion, questions, statements. I'm hoping that we'll hear from a lot of you. It doesn't only have to be a question. I think tonight is also about sharing of stories. I just wanted to make one observation, really out of what both of you shared, which is talking about empowerment, talking about inclusion, talking about what Madeleine Albright said, which I just love that, because women don't always support other women. And I've never understood that either. I wanted to go to a in my head, and we probably many of you marched, and many of you men and women here tonight marched in spirit. But the thing that struck me the most was that itself was a community action. The coming together of women from around the country and around the world. I know people that came from other countries to march in Washington to be there, although there were marches everywhere, and that there was a moment which would have been very hard for me because I'm a little claustrophobic, where nobody physically could move. Everyone just stood and waited and moved together. And I thought about the act of that march and what that said, because I think a lot about social isolation. I've experienced it too, and thank you for just being so open, and also to, in a way, I don't think of it even myself as making friends with social isolation, but in a way it kind of is, because it's always there. And that's also where our empathy comes from. So we're always kind of rising above, but when we suffer and when we fall, when we need that kind of support, my dream is really the way that you outline it. My dream for the world is what you're talking about, is that whenever we encounter someone, we can just be there, and that beacon of light. We can't take away suffering in the world, unfortunately. We can't prevent awful things from happening. I don't think anyone should ever seek out to make a mistake, because we will all make plenty on our own. But what we can do, each one of us, is to go sit beside the person who feels as if they're sitting alone at the bottom of a well. And if you feel that's where you are, then that is where you are. But we can also mitigate the isolation that comes with suffering. And we can mitigate it by not being afraid to stand with someone that we may not be able to help. But by standing there, and that's what struck me about this march, it wasn't where I, you know, I've seen, and we've all seen, if a woman is the victim of domestic violence, the victim of rape, she still has to prove her value, her honesty, her integrity in court, that she just didn't make this up. And that still happens. And I think about, wouldn't it be great, obviously, if that didn't happen, but that a bunch of other women went there and stood there with her in that moment so that no one ever feels alone. And what you were talking about, both of you were talking about, the stories that you were sharing made me think about empowerment, what it means to empower as opposed to have power, because power is something that you take. You can't, no one can, I don't think, really share your, you know, give away some of your power. What in the world does that mean? But when we're empowered, which was what that march was about, to me that's the spirit of, in my parlance, social connectedness. It doesn't have to be called that, but we know it when we feel it, when we have that spirit of being together. And just like bringing a smile into a classroom, or how we agree. It's things that we should not be complacent about or take for granted, because when that happens, we don't have community, and we wonder why we get results or the opposite of what we wanted. So I really wanted to thank you. Say that really, what both of you said and the stories that you shared really brought that home. So comments, questions, ideas, stories, whatever you'd like to share.
Hi, my name is Sabrina. Hello, guys. First of all, I want to thank you for sharing. It was beautiful. I was coming in tired, and my mind was now rested, and you both fed and soothed my mind. So you're brilliant. You're important. Thank you so much. I want to say, so I heard you both about what you said, and it's fantastic, and I would love to talk more. As a woman researcher, I'm very much aware of how my colleagues and myself, my female colleagues, all talk a lot about, or at least suffer from, the imposter syndrome. And the imposter syndrome, meaning like when you go to write something or put your voice out there, yeah, but who am I to say that? Okay, I have the data to back it up and the analysis and two master degrees and a PhD, but really, who am I to say that? So I'd like to ask you ladies if you have seen in your past or on your work initiatives that help or that measure or that at least put the highlight on this issue, because it's quite widespread and I know a lot of men suffer from it too. But I'm not quite sure it's equal.
Sabrina, could I ask before you, both of you respond, can you tell us what that means to you? Not everyone will know the term imposter syndrome, and I know what that means because I've experienced it, but would you mind just to tell us what that is?
Well, to me it means the questioning of yourself, the lack of, I'd say confidence, but saying, okay, so I've been invited to speak out or to speak upon a topic that you're probably an expert on, but you still doubt yourself and still think, well, maybe it's not my place. Maybe I'm a fraud. That's the feeling of saying, I'm such a fraud talking about this or writing this piece. I have no right to speak on that. So that's something that literally freezes people. Especially in the PhD track, in research, and even in other tracks. But I see a lot of that. And my second question would be how to better train or make sure that men are engaged and keep being engaged as our allies in this separation. I'm so happy you talked about this case of a woman having 110% of the qualifications and a man having 30%. But sometimes it takes a man to tell you, you know, I applied for that job. And sometimes it doesn't really hit you and you don't really think anything of it. But if men would lend their voice to say, to highlight what is happening, to say, well, actually, you could actually reach out for that, but at least to be more transparent, maybe we'd have more leeway.
So one of the things about the imposter syndrome, one of the things I've realized, if you don't wake up saying, am I really good enough to do this? You're not challenging yourself enough. So I actually see the imposter syndrome as something really positive. So one of the things is if you're feeling really comfortable with exactly where you are, you're not challenging yourself. And what happens is the way boys play is messy, rough. And so this idea of falling, of hurting yourself, of getting up is something that unconsciously that they have more in terms of how they learn how to play. And girls don't necessarily learn how to play in ways that failure isn't associated to shame. And so one of the things that I find really important is that whatever I have to contribute is my contribution to the world. Is it the greatest? Is it the worst? It's somewhere in between. And so that question of judging myself, that voice that says, I'm not good enough, I'm not good enough, I'm not good enough, it will always be there. But there's also another voice that says, you were born, you were an innocent seed that came into this world, and you have light to share. And so it's a choice. Which voice do you feed, nurture? And they will always be there. And the bigger, greater things you're going to do, the louder that voice will get. It will never diminish. And so what I've realized is there is that voice, but there are other voices. And part of it is, do I create enough space, enough silence, so that I get to hear those other voices?
That's really important what you said, but if I may, Sabrina, because we've talked about this before, is that not every man or woman is able to hear that other voice that you're talking about, the one that says you're not challenging yourself enough. And I would say that this is a role that women, we can do better at supporting one another, but also men have a big role here to play too. Now I want to look up all the research about this, but you know, I have a hunch that women have the imposter syndrome experience a lot more than men do. And I'm gonna go make another hunch, is that that's because there's a fairly long human history where women have continued to fight for our place. I loved when you talked about when we want, you know, I want to take my place at the table. I feel like my job is to say, and you already have your place at the table. Now you need to take your, but not every, you're a wonderful role model. But I just think maybe not everyone can do that. And I wanted to move, if it's okay, to just see if there's anyone here, it's not an audience, I mean, we're all together, that also, including students, that is, you know, I that has ever kind of experienced that I'm not good enough, and what can be done about it. And of course, when we're talking about feminist psychology, as you pointed out, it's women and men. I mean, this is, we're talking about a perspective that I think is rooted in compassion.
So the initial research around the imposter syndrome was done around women in the workforce. They later started also doing research on men, and they found that the imposter syndrome was also present in men. But what happens is, because men have a harder time opening to their vulnerability, the expression and the realization of the consciousness around the imposter syndrome isn't necessarily there, because women will internalize, and so that voice of the imposter syndrome will be really loud. But men will become violent, and so that imposter syndrome, instead of saying, oh, you're not good enough, you'll beat your wife and she's not good enough. And so how things get externalized or internalized will determine how it's lived out. So there is a lot of research in that space. And Amy Cuddy at Harvard, who has the book on presence, I don't know if any of you have looked at it or looked at her TED Talk. One of the things she talked about overcoming the imposter syndrome is posing for where you want to be, and so how your physical embodiment in the moment can help you get out of that space of helplessness into new states, and so how body can take you to confidence over time.
It's interesting, your reference to play. So part of what we're doing in some of the programs I'm working on is really redefining what play looks like, and what is the, how do we redefine gender norms in play as well when we want to encourage inclusive play? Mm. And it's interesting to see in that process young girls who are taking up different space than they may have previously occupied in play circles. So I think starting with messaging and behavior and promotion of values really young is crucial to making sure those spaces do exist for women. I think mentorship and strong role models are key. People who have had similar journeys or who are in the same field as you, who have gone through what you may be dealing with or confronting, are really critical for helping to boost you up and say, yes, you can do this. I did do this, and we're going to work together to see how you get through this. And then I think imagining, as you said, that space of where you want to be and take up room. So often I see women who say, you know, there is no space for me at the table. And a large part of that, I think, is imagining the space that may not be exactly the same space that is being occupied by men at that table, but creating the space and making sure that you take up that space. If you've been asked to talk on something or give your opinion, obviously the people who have invited you to do so feel that you're worthy and valid and have something to contribute. And so imagining yourself there and making sure that you take up that space is really important.
Who else would like to? Yeah, please. And if you could say your name as well. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Will. And I guess, I don't know whether you've heard of this, but sort of Baldwin College recently had sort of a few students, they sort of had signs that says, you know, we're Asian and there are certain stereotypes associated with it. Sort of, you know, we don't ask whether whether English is our first language or not, stuff like that. And I guess to me, one of the frustrations of the conversation, at least, is that a lot of times it puts people into boxes. It almost feels like, you know, if you don't fit that certain mold, for example, if you're not Asian, if you don't fit those certain molds or certain points, that you can't talk about this. And it has created sort of a very divisive environment, in my mind, at least when even talking about sort of minorities or talking about the Asian perspective. A lot of people don't feel like they can talk about it because they don't fit, you know, if you're not Asian, you can't talk about certain perspectives. And I'm interested in sort of where do we draw the balance between we need to have more conversation, that's always important, but and how do you draw the balance between conversation and activism at the same time? Because it just seems that some of the activism, some of the rhetoric that you hear has been very divisive and has been shutting certain groups out. And to me, that's the frustration.
I think there is a lot of divisiveness that's happening. I know what I'm really interested in looking at is where are the places that we share commonality and where are the places where, as humanists, there's overlap in our experience. And I think if we can find places to talk about this and where our experiences do overlap, there's a potential for momentum and activism in that is not divisive and that brings people together.
One of the things I realize is everybody wants to be heard. Mm-hmm. And everybody deserves to be heard with compassion. And being heard doesn't mean I am going to scream at you and just vomit my issues, but it's I need to have my humanity recognized. And I feel pain when I realize that there's so many people on this planet who don't get to feel recognized in their humanity. And that should be a basic right. Every single person should have that right to have their humanity recognized. And so for me, what's really important is for that space of needing that space of recognition. Kim was talking about the need for community. Mm-hmm. And you talked about community as well. And so one of the things is, how do we find communities where we can look into somebody else's eyes, and what they see and what I see in their eyes is a version of myself that has even more radiance. And so one of the things I encourage, especially from teenagehood, young adulthood, is who are your friends? Who are the people around you? And when you look in their eyes, do you see a better self? And if you can really consciously look out for people who have your back in that sense. And that's really what true friendship is somebody who sees you and you're feeling down and says, no, I see you, I see your light, I'm here for you. Cultivating that space is something that consciously we should strive to do every day.
I would love to hear from any of the students.
My name is Fazia, and I was just thinking about the feeling of not being good enough, and my opinion is that, you know, having good role models might help, but I think considering what is going on in the world, we need to look at other factors influencing that feeling of I'm not good enough. And, you know, being a Muslim girl, I'm from Africa, English is not my first language, you know. So I think looking at those factors, and our solution should be focused on making people feel that they belong, making people feel valued and respected. Because sometimes that feeling of I'm not good enough is influenced by other factors. So when we focus on giving people a sense of belonging just not tolerating them is going to help them feel empowered, and they'll be able to speak up and, you know, to help in the long run.
Thank you, Kim.
For those of you who know me, you'll know that I come from a background where women are told pretty early on that they are not good enough. So for me, this imposter syndrome has been with me since as long as I can remember. And I've always used it as a driving force to prove to people that I am good enough, but that has followed me even in the academic world. And when I was writing what I wanted to say for tonight, I had a bit of that, of a moment of, well, who am I to say these things? Maybe I should stick to facts because maybe they don't want to hear my opinion. But then I said to myself, well, who am I not to say these things? Because if we all waited for external validation to speak, then we would live in a very quiet world. So I really appreciate the positive twist that you put on it, saying that you need to challenge yourself and that you need to also take care of yourself, because when you do feel like there's no one else, then you become very important to yourself.
Yeah, I wanted to thank you for sharing that, and you did a great job, by the way. I don't make it easy when I ask people to introduce me, because I just say, here's a little thing, if you want to, it's a bit of my bio, and then really say what you want. I mean, say what you think about this, and which is like zero direction. And time after time, including tonight, it's like, wow, once again, I was blessed with the best students, because you are sharing where you, even if you don't tell your story, you're sharing what you believe. And I, you know, thank you, Kim. Thank you very much. Scholars have argued that unleashing the economic ingenuity of women is the key to lifting communities and countries out of poverty. And I wanted to see if there are any examples that you could discuss where that rang true.
A few years ago, I was in this exact room, and I had the privilege of saying hello to Wangari Maathai before she died.
Oh, wow.
In this room. And so meeting her was a very powerful moment. So here's this woman who's a scientist, who's studying veterinary science, and who went back home and was marginalized in her university and was trying to figure out what she was to do with her life. And her marriage wasn't working, and she separated from her husband, and she had to take care of herself and her children, and started planting trees with women in rural Kenya. And because of that, she went to prison, she was beaten. I mean, she went through so much hardship. And now the university where she was marginalized actually has like a whole huge space that is on in her honor, named after her. A billion trees have been planted on this planet through her initiative. And so in terms of unleashing economic power, mitigating climate change, increasing agriculture productivity, raising water tables so that erosion doesn't happen, the power of this one woman is something that I will always cherish.
I also wanted to weave in the topic that hasn't woven itself in yet tonight. So, to talk about the travel ban that is very much in the headlines these days, including a severe crackdown on refugee intake by the United States. Other countries are also facing pressure to close their doors. How can women in particular oppose these voices and help support refugees amidst what has been called the greatest humanitarian crisis since World War II? And that's a question I'm asking and considering within myself. I want to say you don't have to this is to both of you, but to all of you, and maybe Fauzi, if you want to, because you reacted, which I'd love to hear what you think. It's been called the travel ban. It's also been called the Muslim ban. I think that this is really important to call out now because of what's happening now. And also because I see very much the role of the kind of collaborative thinking about feminism and what it stands for, and certainly the voices of women to stand up for all people who are marginalized. It's huge. And to have the courage to do this and to stand together is to me the greatest example of all. But I would love it if anybody here might comment, think about this. How do you feel about this? Because if it was normally, we'd be having a class the day after Sauvé, and I would begin that class that we're not going to have tomorrow. Sad. I would begin that with just kind of a circle, because we were mostly feeling like we were in a circle about what is this telling us? What is happening today? And to me, that is the giant in the room.
It's very disappointing for me. I've been on CNN all the time. I want to know what is going on. Every time I get to my apartment, I turn on the TV. And it's very disappointing to know that a country that, you know, I was very proud of, and a country we all admire to go to school there, and everybody's is very scared. And, you know, being a Muslim, and I know Islamic culture, I know Arab culture, they are totally different. Islam and Arabic is totally different. So looking at the media and how Arabic culture and Islamic culture are mistaken, like the two are combined together, they're all called Islam. It's very disappointing to me. I feel that, like, there's a lot of ignorance out there. And I feel like as women, we need to support each other and not to judge each other by the way we dress. And sometimes, because, you know, personally, I feel like putting on the hijab makes me feel beautiful and more confident. I remember the first time I was with Kim, I was actually very scared to take it off, because I feel like, oh my God, I have such an ugly head. That is the reason I cover something on my head. So sometimes I feel like we need to listen to one another, and we should know the stories behind why are these women covering up. Yes, of course, if somebody's forced to put on the hijab, I don't support that. And, you know, we should speak to them. And you can't know if they're forced if you're judging them from a distance. You need to just speak to them and get to know why they're putting it on. Is it for religious reasons or for cultural reasons? They're two different things. I've been to Dubai, and it's different. It's their culture. It's not Islam. Even if they're not Muslims, they just put it on. So I feel like there is a difference that people do not know about, and that is what is... It just makes me very sad to know that until this day, people cannot differentiate between the Saudi Arabian culture and the Islamic culture. And when I look at the news and UAE and Saudi Arabia are not on the list, I feel very disappointed. And to me, I just call the US, I don't care, they're just hypocrites. Because they get so much, you know, Saudi Arabia is known to abuse women's rights, so many things going on. I'm a Muslim, and I know how they treat women, and I do not support it. So I feel like, you know, not including Saudi Arabia, the 9/11, that the people include were from Saudi Arabia, and it's not on the list, I feel very disappointed. Sometimes I wish I could do something, but I still feel belittled, and I still feel like, you know, when you just stand and you feel like, I wish I could just tell this guy to just come over and I could do something, but you can't do something. And I wish I could have the platform to teach people about Islam. And, you know, but it's just very saddening. And as women, I think we should support each other and listen to one another and not judge one another from a distance.
Yeah, right on. Thanks, Felicia.
Hi, everyone. And actually, Fozia, we lived on the same floor first year at McGill, and you're one of the first Muslim people that I met. So it was really important for me, I think, to have the experience of going to such a multicultural school. And speaking about isolation, I think that being here tonight made me think really differently about the issues you just brought up in the light of social isolation, and how, even though I feel surrounded by people who reaffirm the way I feel about these situations, that it's something that I vehemently disagree with. You feel it is a feeling of isolation, even just feeling so apart from the way that possibly half of America does feel. And I was hoping that maybe you two would want to speak to that. And just that even though I feel like, especially the issue of women, I feel like women have come so far, but then yet we needed a women's march. And so how is this, it's hard to be a graduating student as a woman who's facing into joining the workforce. And I wonder, is this like a bubble that I exist in where people are really accepting and I'm gonna enter kind of like this cold, hard place where it's not like that at all? Or how do we create space for ourselves? And I think that a lot of these issues do really poignantly relate to social isolation because people on both sides feel isolated. And how do we start to solve that?
Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing that. So I think it's just really important already. What you did is just to share it because you're looking this way. So what you can't see is a whole room of people nodding with you in support. I wanted you to know that.
What's happening right now, I wouldn't have imagined would have happened in my lifetime. It feels regressive, it feels backwards, it feels alienating, it feels isolating. I think if there's anything that's reassuring that's come out of this, it is the number of people who are talking about it and who are saying, this isn't right, these aren't my beliefs, these aren't my values. Who are wanting to engage, who are wanting to make a difference, who are wanting to ensure that popular opinion in Canada doesn't mirror what is happening in the States right now, that there are people who are concerned and thinking about Islamophobia and how we can be countering prejudices and stereotypes and talking about that in our schools, in our homes, with our friends. And so I'm reassured that there have been those conversations happening. Like you, I feel a certain amount of challenge of what I can personally do in that process. And I know within my organization, one of my very good and close colleagues is Muslim. She's from Morocco. I was with her in Vancouver doing a training with young women leaders when the shootings happened in Quebec City. Similarly, when the news came out of the travel ban, and so part of what we're doing as an organization is sitting down and talking about these things and saying, how can we be making a difference in the programming and with the people we come into contact with? But I think that importance of us not letting it slip off the agenda and being vigilant and continuing to talk about it with each other is really crucial now more than ever.
I was a refugee in 1994. And if I had been put on a plane, I wouldn't have come back alive. And so one of the things for me is there are times where of dehumanization. It's so painful. There are no words. There are no words. All we can do is breathe in the suffering and hope that somehow, someday, we can transmute the suffering. When I think of the shootings in Quebec City, a colleague of mine at McGill knew one of the men who had been praying and was killed. And I had looked up the names of every person and I had noticed one of them was a professor at Laval University, and this happened to be a friend of my colleague at McGill. And I'd noticed that his wife was also a professor at University Laval. And so this could have been here. And so one of the things for me, because isolation, it's also, we have to think, what does it take to become somebody who goes into a mosque and shoots people? Why? What level of isolation, of internalized violence pushes you to go and find a gun, to go into a holy place and shoot people? And for me, in terms of inclusion, it's how do we include everybody? And how do we allow the vulnerability of men to be expressed in ways that don't marginalize, that doesn't produce violence, and that promotes and encourages all of humanity? And so it's how do we raise our sons? And there's an expression of, if boys aren't allowed to cry tears, they cry bullets. And so this is something in terms of everywhere in the world. You know, if a boy cries, don't be a girl. How can the tears of a boy be recognized, nurtured, so that his vulnerability, his humanity can be recognized?
Please.
Hi, I'm Sarah. Just in returning to the travel ban and what we can do, and I think especially in this context of being among other academics, the call to boycott American conferences and the debates that have been rising up surrounding that on both sides of how do we kind of stand together as people who want to engage with this, who want to do something and take different positions, and how do we actually try to find a way that we can move forward imperfectly, not knowing what the proper way of resisting and standing up is. How do we manage to both stand with our colleagues that we feel are being excluded from the conversation, but also make sure that we, as people who are able to participate in that conversation, can still present those voices.
Great point.
Yeah, you know, you raise an excellent question. Does anyone here have any thoughts about that? How do we think, maybe if I can summarize it, is how can we raise our voices? And maybe, I guess how I interpret it is what is our appropriate role? What is our each one of us can decide that, but maybe it's, you know, do we maybe come back to that question of what does resistance look like, right? Is resistance activism? Go ahead, Sarah.
And I think the question that came up earlier about divisiveness, of being careful about when that divisiveness is actually removing support. So saying that we can come together with different opinions about the resistance and that we are actually colleagues and we are allies in this, and and our energy shouldn't be this kind of infighting. It needs to go toward, there's so much energy being pulled from us that it feels like we need to redirect that and make sure that we're there standing with each other in our differences in resistance and actually moving forward.
Fantastic point. So anyone else who wants to share, please.
And I think a lot of this has sort of been, the election obviously of Trump has been very divisive, and I have no Trump support at all. But there seems to be, you know, and I know people close to me who are Trump supporters who at least support Trump, and I know that they're not racist in any way, or they're not, you know, they might, you know, support some of Trump's policies, but they don't sort of exhibit as much as what Trump's rhetoric has done. And I guess going back to your point is that, yeah, it seems like how do we understand someone who disagrees with us, and it goes back to my original question, is I just feel like sometimes much of the conversation has been labeling people, and we're calling everyone racist, and that word has been dished out a little too easily in my mind. But how do we sort of reconcile with a Trump supporter, for example, and say that, you know, some of your ideas are inherently wrong, but you might be of a position of sort of socioeconomically stranded, in a sense. You might be from the Midwest or something, you have certain struggles that you're trying to tell people. And in a way, I think that reflection, that election has sort of reflected that there are, whether it's globalization or sort of the economic disparity, there are some struggles that Trump supporters are facing, and how do we sort of reconcile that, but acknowledging that some of their ideas coming from Trump is inherently wrong.
You know, I think if you don't mind, Will, yeah. I think what I'm going to do, if it's okay, is to maybe have your question be something that we can be discussing after the session, only because I want to try to bring us near to the concluding, particularly on the role of women. But what I did want to do is to call out to me the essence of what you just said, because it's very similar to what Sarah just said, which is how can we find common ground even when it isn't apparent on the surface, and certainly when something is politicized that much, we've already lost. We've already lost the potential for common ground. I think, though, I'm Canadian, so I don't have a party in the U.S., but I'm not sure that I could stand for anyone that was going to support the banning of any group of people. And I wonder, and I just want to put this as a question, I wonder how many Trump supporters are now thinking, oh my God, because it doesn't mean that they're not decent people. I mean, it's right, but I also think we need to make, from the social connectedness point of view, pathways for people that are now hopefully feeling, oh my God, I may have supported this candidate this week because I'm not doing well economically. I feel that all these kinds of reasons, but not because I support hatred or othering or demoralizing or putting somebody in a box or, as you said, labeling. And I think that in that case, and coming back to this, which I'm looking at what you said, and a lot of what's been said, and particularly in the last 15 minutes about, I'm thinking about, and what is this in the context of women and in the broader context of feminism? Our prime minister calls himself a feminist, and he is, and I love that. So men are, there's no label of men, women, with this, we are all in this together, and I love when men take action on, for example, Sarah, you mentioned about conferences. That I love when there's a wonderful, small and powerful movement of men that say they won't go on a panel if there's not a woman there. I mean that's to me is a very concrete action. But I think it's underneath all of this. What we're talking about tonight is, what are your core beliefs? What do we stand for? And what does it mean to be human? And I think what it means to be human can actually end up to be we talked about it this afternoon, about a lot of what's happened in history isn't all that good, is it? But the best of humanity, and it comes back to what you say, that we always have a choice. We always have a choice. We tend to make better choices when we can see eye to eye and realize that there is no other, that the other is always us. I think I'm probably going to close it there, but I also want to ask if there's anyone who just simply wants to share, because there's a lot of men and also a lot of women tonight that I know a lot of you from class have a lot to share and haven't maybe had a chance to speak up. It doesn't mean you have to, but if you'd like to, this would be a good time just to share a comment and insight. Because we've brought up a lot tonight.
Go back to the point about the importance of having a mentor and strong female role models. I think that one of you made. I just want to emphasize how much in my 4 years at McGill, that's been something that's so important to me and really helped me be confident. I've definitely had imposter syndrome. I'm always the person who thinks that, why am I doing this? I'm not actually prepared for this, I'm not qualified, but people like Kim and other amazing women at McGill have really made me realize that I am competent and able to do all of these things. So I just want to say thank you to Kim, first of all, and all of my other amazing role models at McGill that believed in me and believed and really are helping create the next generation of strong women leaders.
Yeah, thank you. And I wanted to say to Tessa, what you said at the end, because I think it got not really lost, but the conversation moved quickly. You know, I think a lot about your generation, which is also, I have a daughter just a little bit older than all of you, not much, and she's struggling with this. And I, as her mom, I think maybe my mom was the same way, thinking this world that our young women, our daughters, are moving into, with all of the progress that's been made, are still going to have it really, really tough. And that saddens me greatly. I mean, I can't, you know, the job market comes up and down. We need more women in science. We need more role models. You asked that question, and you're absolutely right. Why do we need a women's march? Why do we still need a women's march? That's a really valid question. Why do we still need to fight so hard to be heard, to take our place at the table when we already have our place at the table? We still have to convince people of that. And I've learned quite a bit about the academic community, how hard it is for women to make it as academics. One of our speakers in guest lectures, I should say, in class this fall is an amazing young professor in sciences from Yale University called Angel Hsu, and she didn't really get a chance to share in class, what I want to share with all of you now, which is how hard it is to be a female academic. She graduated, she had a PhD in science, environmental science is her field. We're going to be hearing a lot about her in the future. She went off to Yale in Asia to teach her first year of teaching last year, and she was ridiculed by one of this part won't be taped just for us, but I'm mentioning a specific university, and so I don't. Okay. But she was ridiculed by the department head in front of others, saying, "You know, we're just kind of going to put up with you, but let's everyone know Angel doesn't really have a lot to share." Can you imagine? I know. So, and I was just, you know, hearing this, and she, you know, I thought I want her to come back because she did such an amazing, she was amazing, right? She was an amazing lecturer, an incredible teacher, an incredible amount to share, but I actually want her to come back to tell that story because she's one of your role models, right? She's a role model. And she told me on a tenure track that if you are, if there's one woman competing against the men that she has a lot less chance of succeeding. There's two women, there's always a better chance that one of them is going to make it. And so I wanted to just to kind of bring, because I think your question, I wish I had an answer. I don't. I just know that it's going to be probably just as tough for your generation as it was for mine. And I don't have a reason for that to say. I don't know a reason to explain why that is, but to say it's also probably the most exciting generation because now, hopefully, and in gatherings like this, you can stand up and say that and know that you couldn't see the nodding, but all of the there were men nodding too, but especially your current, past roommates and others in the room. Yeah, I know what it's like too. And I think that if we can get rid of that stigma, because we think it's only us, and just so you know, I still go through that, and I kind of sometimes take a deep breath and say, wait a minute, that's what it feels like, but that's not what it's like now. But that's, you know, I've got 30 more years experience like this, and I know you're going to face the same things, but please don't make the mistake that I did and a lot of my generation is thinking that other women are there to compete against. That's not true. You do your best. We're all competing against ourselves. We're all high achievers. But also to get that, you know, if we can get that model of we're there for each other, then we're all going to go up together. It's that rising tide lifts all boats. And that includes the men, especially the men in the audience, especially who can have a make an amazing impact on their, most of you aren't fathers yet, but on young women, and those of you that become fathers of young women, you have a huge role to play in fostering the somebodiness of those amazing girls. Well, thank you very, very much. And we are now going to have refreshments and more conversation. And I hope that this is the beginning of a dialogue tonight that we can continue for a very long time. And I want to say that you two have been remarkable and stimulating. And this was a lot to consider and speak to and respond to tonight. You did a phenomenal job. So cheers.